give a round of applause for our today's dignitaries and chief guests. Thank you. So without further ado, because we all are waiting for a very important inaugural event, and since we, all of us, gather here for the very important cause, that's the exhibition Outbreak Epidemics in a Connected World, which is going to be already inaugurated by our today's chief guest in presence of Dr. Jha and Dr. Udwadia. So without further ado, I would like to invite our director, Sri Kenneth, sir, for giving welcome address. Thank you, sir.
Good evening. I have a sore throat, so you'll have to bear with my voice today. It's a great honor and privilege for the Nehru Science Centre to be hosting this very important exhibition, Outbreak Epidemics in a Connected World. And we're honored to have two distinguished guests with us. May I, on behalf of the visitors to the Science Centre, you wonderful college students, I will request Miss Avani, Avani to welcome Dr. Zarir Udwadia with a flower bouquet. May I request Kaveri Medsari, she works as education trainee with us, to formally welcome Dr. Jha, please, Ashish Jha, with a flower bouquet. I'm just searching. We are extremely honored to have with us Dr. Farooq Udwadia. May I request Akshata Bhosle to formally welcome Dr. Senior Udwadia. this event, it all started, the ball started rolling for this event, courtesy one person who is here with us. She incidentally, they're also the education partner for us. So I would like to request Ms. Sonali Loke to formally welcome Bunty Chanji with flower bouquet. The year 2018 is the centenary year of one of the world's worst epidemic that struck the world, and 50 to 100 million people died because of this epidemic. India was not spared either. We lost about 15 to 20 million people. More and more urbanization is taking place now. This is a connected world where we tend to cohabit with the animal kingdom. That's where all these infectious diseases, the outbreaks can happen. So this one exhibition, which has been developed by the Smithsonian Institution and brought to us by Harvard Global Health Institute here, will help us in understanding the ways and means to actually avoid such outbreaks. I'm not going to stand before you because there's going to be a keynote address, which I'm sure you'll all be enjoying. Once again, welcome you to the Nehru Science Centre. Okay, thank you.
So now I'll invite Sri Umesh Kumar, sir, the curator and head of the education cell, to introduce our today's very important scientist and Dr. Ashish Jha, sir. Thank you.
Good evening. It's a privilege for me to introduce Dr. Ashish Jha. He's Dean for Global Strategy and Katie Lee Professor of Global Health at the Harvard T.S. Chan School of Public Health and the Director of Public Harvard Global Health Institute. He is also a practicing general internist at the VA Boston Healthcare System and Professor of Medicine at Harvard Medical School. Dr. Jha received his MD from Harvard Medical School and then trained in internal medicine at University of California in San Francisco. He completed his general medicine fellowship at Brigham and Women's Hostel at Harvard Medical School and received his master degree in physiology from Harvard T.H. Chan School of Public Health. His research endeavors focus on improving the quality and cost of healthcare system with a specialized focus on the impact of policies. Dr. Jha has published over 200 empirical papers and writes regularly about ways to improve healthcare system, both in US and globally. Dr. Jha was elected as member of National Academy of Medicine in 2013. We are fortunate to have him here. I'll request him to take over the dais.
Thank you. Good afternoon, good evening, everybody. Thank you so much, for all of you, for being here. Very big thanks to the director, Kened, and the folks at the Nehru Science Centre for collaborating with us on this very important effort. So as the introduction said, my name is Ashish Jham, the director of the Harvard Global Health Institute. And before I say a few quick remarks, I just want to pass along regrets of my dean, Michelle Williams, who was going to be here this evening. Unfortunately, she fell ill this afternoon, was not quite able to make it, and so she passes along her regrets. But Michelle and I have been working together as partners on this effort. So let me tell you a little bit about what brings us together here this evening. As you heard, this is the 100th anniversary of something known as the Spanish flu. So the question is, anybody in the audience know why it's called the Spanish flu? Did it originate in Spain? So no one's going to speak up, so I will tell you. I'm looking around for hands. I don't see any. It's called the Spanish flu because Spain was not involved in World War I. It was not on either side of the war. And because the flu happened during the war, and there was media blackout in almost every country, the only country that had a press that actually reported the influenza outbreak was Spain. And so while between 50 and 100 million people died around the world, it turned out that only Spain was reporting any influenza outbreaks, and therefore everybody calls it the Spanish flu. This is the downside of having a free press. You get tarred in history for having the worst outbreak. It remains to this day the worst outbreak we've ever had. If you think about a new pandemic, a new disease outbreak, more people have died from the Spanish flu or the 1918 flu pandemic than any other disease outbreak in human history. So that remains a challenge. There are pandemics, there are disease outbreaks that are starting to catch up. And if you think of HIV as a new pandemic that started in the late 1970s, early 1980s, about 35 million people have died from HIV. And all projections are that it's going to hit over 50 million. So at some point, HIV might surpass the flu. So this exhibit, which was a collaboration between us at the Harvard Global Health Institute and the Smithsonian exhibit, Institution, was created to mark the 100th anniversary. And the idea behind it was that not only do we want to commemorate the 100th anniversary of this awful event, but we need to learn lessons from it. We have to learn lessons from the fact that at a time in the world where we were far less connected than we are today, between 50 and 100 million people died. And if you think about where we are today, 4 days ago, I was in Boston. Yesterday, I was in Delhi. Today, I'm in Mumbai. 4 days from now, I'm going to be in Hong Kong. I could be the perfect disease vector that could spread any infectious disease quickly and efficiently around the world. I promise you, I actually feel well today, and I don't think I am going to. But the point is that this kind of global travel has become commonplace. And if you take a disease like Ebola, which has an incubation period of 9 days, somebody could get infected in one place, and they could start showing symptoms and spread a disease by themselves around the world. In some ways, that is a bit of what happened in 2014 when a gentleman from Liberia ended up in the United States with Ebola. And we are going to see more and more of that. One of the other themes which you've heard about already is that most of these diseases come from animals. About 75 to 80% of new disease outbreaks come from animals. And so more and more, the strategy for dealing with this is thinking about one health, thinking about the health of animals, thinking about the health of humans, and realizing that they are not separate issues. And we have to be working with the animal health industry if we're going to protect human beings. One last comment before I introduce our keynote speaker for tonight, and that is that if you, we've talked about the 1918 flu pandemic, which killed between 50 and 100 million people. It did so over about a 9 to 12 month period, very quickly. And between 15 and 20 million people died in India. Right? Think about a disease outbreak that killed almost 20 million people in India over a course of months, not years. And one of the questions is, how do we prevent the next one? And you know, there's an old saying that for every complex problem, there is a solution that's simple and neat and wrong. Well, this too is a complex problem, and there is no simple solution. And if we're going to make progress on preventing the next big pandemic, we have to do a variety of things. One is we certainly have to work on improving public health systems, right? Surveillance. One of the other things we need to do is work on vaccines. When the Ebola outbreak hit West Africa, we didn't have a vaccine for Ebola. We do now, it's gotten much better, and we think it's working reasonably effectively. But we need to have new vaccines, we need to have new treatments. We need a public health infrastructure that can respond. And there are no shortage of remarkable things about this country, my homeland, India, but one of the things that is an issue is that we continue to underinvest in public health. And if we are going to be ready for the next pandemic as a nation, we have to make public health investments a much higher priority than it has been. So with that, let me talk about we've talked a lot about emerging and new diseases. There is a disease that's been with us for a very long time, right, which is tuberculosis. And it continues to kill more than 1 million individuals every year. And about 500,000, or about 500,000 people who die every year, die in India. So this is a disease that has been, I think, neglected in some ways. And over the last 18 months, we have finally seen a resurgence in interest. And one person who has not been neglecting this in any way, and has been not just a leader in India, but really one of the leaders in the globe on TB, is our keynote speaker, Dr. Zarir Udwadia. He is not somebody who needs an introduction here, but let me take 30 seconds and say a few things, and then I will turn it over. So he is our keynote speaker for the evening. He's a consulting test physician at Hinduja and Breechcandy Hospitals. He has immense expertise in TB, and particularly drug-resistant TB, sees as many as 10,000 patients a year, which is an incredible clinical load. And you would think somebody with that kind of clinical expertise would have no time for writing scientific papers. He's published more than 150 scientific papers while doing all of this. These papers have been cited over 7,000 times. So there are times you just write a paper, it gets published. These papers have changed the way we think about TB. These papers have been highly cited because they are at the cutting edge of the science of TB. And whenever the world finally starts paying attention to TB and realizes they need to go to the leading global experts, they come to Dr. Udwadia. So we are thrilled this evening that he took time not just out of his busy clinical and scientific schedule, but just out of his schedule where he's doing so many remarkable things to come and talk to us about drug-resistant TB in India. Dr. Udwadia, thank you so much for being here.
Dean Jha, thank you very much for your kind words. It's such a pleasure to be associated with the Harvard School, which is really at the pinnacle of global health internationally. In keeping with the theme of the exhibition today, I've chosen as my topic drug-resistant TB in India, a global epidemic in a connected world. And if I can figure out how to. This one?
Yeah, this one.
Yeah. No. If I can begin by making you compare and contrast two deadly, equally deadly diseases, I'd say. One is an outbreak, Ebola, and the other an epidemic, multidrug-resistant tuberculosis. And note, if you will, the difference in the way they are transmitted. Ebola by close personal contact, direct contact with the patient, and you will notice the extreme caution with which these healthcare workers in Sierra Leone transfer this poor lady to an isolation ward, gloved up, almost space suited. And the other, an epidemic for sure, MDR-TB is an epidemic, not an outbreak. And that is transferred with complete impunity in Bombay's crowded local trains, borne through the air. Each time a person coughs, millions of bacteria released. And just the act of inhalation and breathing is enough to contract this disease. That's me. So if you look at the last, there are outbreaks of Ebola now going on now as we speak, but if you look at the last major outbreak, which lasted 15 months, and if you compare the number of deaths in that same time period between Ebola and MDR-TB, you will find that there were 11,312 Ebola deaths, but in that very same time period, day to day, 2.1 million people died of tuberculosis. You didn't hear about those deaths. They passed under the radar. If you look at the number of secondary cases from each infectious Ebola patient, that numbered 3 per patient. With MDR-TB, it was 10 to 20 per year. These patients live longer than Ebola patients, of course, so they are more infectious and for longer periods of time. I don't want you jumping up each time there is. So, if there's something else I can. Yeah, I'll do it from here. That's fine. Okay. Yeah. The mortality, you might think that Ebola is the more deadly, but in terms of mortality, look, the mortality of XDR-TB certainly is far higher than that of Ebola. Not everyone with Ebola dies. Good supportive care, as Paul Farmer showed, can save a lot of people. So I don't think it's an exaggeration when Stop TB said that MDR-TB is Ebola with wings. And it seems almost incredible that during the last two centuries, a single disease, tuberculosis, was responsible for the deaths of 1,000 million human beings. Now, how do you wrap your mind around a figure that vast? And remember, the terror did not stop there. It went on and on, back over the millennia, relentlessly, this stain of death across 4 continents, which stretched back in history almost forever. So the bug which causes this disease is Mycobacterium tuberculosis. It's the perfect pathogen. It's an obligate human bug. It's ancient. It's persistent over the millennia. It's airborne, which gives it an added advantage. Its history is really interwoven with the evolution and migration of mankind. And without doubt, it's the single greatest cause of mortality from any pathogen we've known. You'll see from this cartoon in Nature that the number of deaths from TB far outweigh all the other infectious disease killers added up together. So they beat smallpox and malaria and plague and influenza, cholera and AIDS, all added up. A fact not missed by this physician to Louis XVIII, who said, "There is no more dangerous disease than TB, none so common. It destroys a very great part of the human race," because that's what it did do. We know that there has been evidence of TB in human remains right from the Egyptian mummy days, 3000 BC. That's using radiocarbon techniques. But with our modern whole genome sequencing, we can push that backwards 6,000 years, and we find that this is the first known evidence of a skeleton with TB in Heidelberg, of all places. And you can see the kyphotic posture because this poor lady had spine TB. Skeletal TB, and you can see the gibbous formation there. And we know that MTB stretched back much further. It evolved from an early progenitor in East Africa, the Old World, 3 million years ago. And its origin then, from Africa, paralleled those really of humankind. In the early millennia, the Rig Vedas warned that the physician who wants fame can cure a man with consumption. Hippocrates was more circumspect. He said, "It's best to avoid treating these patients because you will sully your reputation." And there was no treatment for TB across the century, none except prayer. And you can see these nurses in Florence Nightingale-type regalia, crouched in repose behind a patient, beneath a patient, beside a patient who was clearly dying of tuberculosis. The great Arthur Conan Doyle said, "What an infernal microbe it is. Surely science will find some way of destroying it," as his wife lay dying of tuberculosis. But in the 19th century, one out of every 4 deaths, a good 25% of all of Europe, all of America, and all of the globe died of tuberculosis. Put bluntly, it was the most common way to die. And I've just put up just a random assortment of some of the great geniuses, creative spirits who died young from tuberculosis. And look at this exalted roster of greats, really, from Jane Austen to Franz Kafka, from Chopin to Chekhov. What did they have in common? They were all young. They all died of TB. They were all creative. And this bred this myth and this misconception that in some way it's romantic to die of TB. Which was wrong, because nothing could be further from the truth. In fact, there was no worse way to die than from tuberculosis. It was a cunning disease. It started slowly and insidiously with a few coughs. It crept up on you and then came in consumption, which is why it was called consumption, because you wasted away. It was almost when you'd lost all your weight and lost all your mass that you had an exsanguinating bleed from your lungs and often died. And even then, when you thought that death was inevitable, it wouldn't come because it was almost as though the consumptive didn't have the energy to muster up the strength to die. They went on and on, often lingering. It was a dreadful, dreadful end. Everything from the tragedy of consumption to the perverted attitude of the Victorians to this disease to the ignorance of 19th century medicine are exemplified in the story of this great man, John Keats. He died of tuberculosis, aged 26, 1821. This is, I don't know if any of you knew or many of you knew that that he was a medical student at Guy's Hospital. And he was primed to get tuberculosis by virtue of his being a medical student, working in the autopsy room where he did spend many of his years. His mother, Martha, died of tuberculosis. His brother, Tom, died of tuberculosis when he was a child. TB ravaged families then, as it does sadly even today. And this is the Guy's Hospital in the background in those days. And this is a statue which still remains in the courtyard of Guy's with John Keats looking forlornly on, dead at the age of 26. The treatment he received, what was the treatment he had in those days? Exercise on horseback. So this is the prescription. Take thou exercise on horseback 2 times a day, bloodletting with leeches for 2 months. And his diet was a solitary anchovy and a slice of bread, because there were the swings in the pendulum, but they felt at that stage that starving a patient was the best way to deal with tuberculosis. This just hastened the end, of course. And then everything changed on this particular date with this great man. I need to tell you a little about Robert Koch, who was one of my heroes, really. On March 24th, 1882, he was a short man with glasses, as you can see, and he stooped a little. He was an Austrian country doctor. And at the age of 39, he got up and addressed this very august gathering of the Berlin Physiology Society. The greatest minds from across Europe were at this meeting. They'd come to hear him speak. His experiments had started about 5 years ago when he became interested in tuberculosis. His wife, Martha, had given him a microscope as a birthday present, which is what he used. He partitioned off his living room with a sheet into a makeshift laboratory. And his work culminated in the talk that he was about to give at the Berlin Society. He started slowly, nervously, and then built up, and after an hour had proven that TB was not caused by vapors or bad air or any of the other ludicrous theories of the 18th century, but was caused by a microbe. So it was a mind-boggling presentation, really. At the end, there was pin drop silence. He was to win the Nobel Prize for this a few years. The fifth Nobel Prize in medicine was awarded to him for this work. There was pin drop silence. No one clapped. There was no congratulation, no questioning. And then the great Rudolf Virchow, who you might have heard of, the czar of medicine in Europe at the time, put on his hat and stormed out of the auditorium. And then we moved from ignorance to an era where antibiotics came in. Look, 70 years after Koch's discovery, nothing till then. In his lifetime, he didn't know that TB could be treated. And then came the first two TB drugs, PASS and streptomycin. Then came DOTS, because we realized we had to give combination therapy, and it had to be under supervision. But then look how we get complacent as human beings. TB had a long, long history, as you've seen. But in just 50 years, the CDC decided to stop funding or cut funding for tuberculosis. The WHO, to their shame, dismantled the existing TB program. And I'm sure these words must have come back to haunt the then US Surgeon General, because he said, it is time to close the book on infectious diseases and declare the war against pestilence won. But TB, of course, was always there. It reemerged. In 1993, it was declared a global crisis. And today, little has changed. At any one time, 10 million people worldwide will develop it. 2 million will die of it. And there are the emergence of these almost untreatable strains, which we grapple with, and I'm glad to see my residents all here, at the Hinduja Hospital almost on a daily basis. TB has never been more in the news. A few months ago in New York, there was a high-level United Nations meeting, the first on any disease. Sadly, our Prime Minister was conspicuous by his absence. So in this country, it exists really on an epic scale. It's our biggest healthcare problem. We have the most new TB cases, the most MDR cases, the most deaths. If you want it in immediate terms, TB still kills one Indian every 2 minutes. And it causes a staggering economic loss. If you're an economist or a health economist, that is a huge figure. And the projections from the CDC in this current Lancet article are that it's only going to get worse. So all this optimistic talk of, oh, we'll eradicate TB by 2030, but the Prime Minister says India will do it by 2025, makes me amused and then angry. We've failed, really, as far as TB goes here in many ways. Our initial national TB program was a disaster. It was underfunded, it wasn't working, and in fact, I believe it bred MDR-TB. Then it was revised about 30 years later, and we embraced DOTS with a huge loan from WHO, a soft loan, and that worked well enough against sensitive strains. There's little doubt that DOTS in India has been a huge success. In fact, it's lauded as a public health success of the highest magnitude. It saved lots of lives. But that's only of the drug-sensitive TB. That's the more easy to treat kind. Then there is MDR. If you were an evil dictator bent on creating an epidemic of MDR-TB in a country, you'd do what we've done in ours over the last 50 years. You'd create a social and economic climate of poverty and inequity and tick these off in your mind and tell me if India doesn't fit all the slots. You'd subject those with infectious TB to squalid and overcrowded living conditions. You'd provide inadequate treatment, a guarantor of drug resistance. And then you'd stir in an unhealthy dose of HIV, of diabetes, of malnutrition, all factors that predispose you to tuberculosis. The majority of the world's MDR cases reside in this country we live in. In fact, one out of every four is an Indian. And if you zoom in, even that is just the tip of the iceberg. Because look, only 50% or less were even tested to see if they had MDR-TB. So the actual figures are probably much, much worse. But these are the kind of maps which excite me even more. This is not a cartoon. It's based on clever mathematical modeling in the Lancet. It's a world map obtained by stretching countries in proportion to their deaths from TB. And you can see, finally, India emerges as a superpower, which we've always dreamed of being, Dr. Jha, and along with Africa. And you'll be happy to know that Europe and America are banished away to the periphery of the universe. And surprise, surprise, this map is almost identical to the poverty map of the world. So the death map from TB and the poverty map are superimposed. And as Paul Farmer said, the poor have no option, do they, but to be at risk of tuberculosis. This is not the New England Journal of Medicine. It's our daily newspaper. But it is a little worrying if you open it while you have your coffee and find that the rates of MDR in your city have risen, 3,600% since 2011. And really, if you zoom in and wanted to design an ideal incubator for tuberculosis, you've done it here in Mumbai. 22 million people in 400 kilometers square. It's a city of contradictions which forces you to feel the raw fight for survival every day. And so we've created this alphabet soup of resistant tuberculosis from MDR to XDR to totally drug-resistant TB. It takes just a couple of treatment errors, two in fact, to convert a sensitive case to an MDR case. You get the dose wrong, you get the drug wrong, and your patient, the bacteria are so wily that they will mutate. Further errors and you get XDR-TB, which is even more difficult to treat, and four drugs don't work. And then further amplification resulted in the kind of strain we first described in 2011 and labeled totally drug-resistant TB. And I like this quote from the bulletins of WHO. MDR-TB is evidence of a new form of regression. We have taken the curable and made it incurable. The tendency was to blame the most vulnerable, the most powerless, our patients. But it's time to recognize that we collectively bear responsibility for this. It's an iatrogenic disease, completely. And we published the first four cases of their kind in this high-impact journal called Clinical Infectious Disease. The article was fast-tracked, to my surprise. The editors must have thought it was worth getting out quickly. And we defined it as we saw it. The question I'm always asked is, so how did you define totally drug-resistant TB? There were critics, of course. Well, we defined it as we saw it. We saw patients who were resistant to every single drug that the Hinduja Hospital, which I think has a state-of-the-art mycobacterial lab, was capable of testing. If that's not total, I don't know what is. I think it wouldn't be an exaggeration to say, as we were talking before we started, that it did shake up TB control in this country. It brought drug resistance out of the closet. It brought attention to these people who were dying of virtually untreatable TB. And it did focus a lot of medical and public attention on this problem. This poor patient of mine made the cover of Time magazine, but didn't live to see it. And at one stage, I began to wonder, with all the frenzy, whether TDR stood for triggering dramatic responses, because the media can go over the top as well, as you can imagine. Our first patient exemplifies totally drug-resistant TB. She was a resident of Dharavi, so impoverished. 5 years of TB, getting nowhere. Public sector, private sector treatment, crisscrossing states, infecting people along the way. An X-ray which showed a ravaged left lung and a resistance pattern which looked like this. We're used to seeing bad resistance patterns at the Hinduja Hospital where I work, but this one was resistant across the board to every single drug that our microbiologists could test for. We tried everything, including surgery, but she died prior to death with an X-ray looking like this. And I learned a lot from this poor lady. I learned that untreatable forms of TB are increasingly encountered, and that such patients have virtually no drug options, and new drugs are desperately needed. So how did we get here? Delays in diagnosis. The average TB patient in this country, these are average figures, is diagnosed after a delay of 2 months. So that's the period of time when they're spreading infection in very crowded communities. And this is a study from Nargish, who's in the audience, and she showed that the average MDR patient, in contrast, is even more difficult to diagnose, and it takes 6 months before they're diagnosed. Again, an unacceptable delay for what is really India's biggest health problem. And of course, we know that the only way to break this transmission cycle and reduce morbidity and mortality is by treating them early, and you can't treat them early till you diagnose them. This is one of my patients, poor man from the rural areas, who would come to us, and look at the Faustian choices that he faces. He can choose, India is a democracy, at least when I last checked, and you can choose to go down the public or the private pathway. And did you know that 30% only will choose the public pathway? That must be telling you something about the quality of service there if an impoverished farmer in Uttar Pradesh will sell his cattle or his wife's jewelry, but still choose to go to the local quack in the private sector instead of going to the DOTS clinic, which welcomes him for free. If he goes down the public pathway, he has little choice. He gets a standardized regime, a one-size-fits-all regime, which we've been arguing over the decades will only serve to amplify resistance. Look, you don't give people drugs to which you know they're resistant. And sadly, that, because of convenience, because of, I think, health economics is what the program is forced to do. Suppose he were to go private. Well, then he'd have many choices. But in this country, many choices don't translate into better choices because he can end up with a homeopath and Ayurveda and Unani. And most of them will do even worse than what the public sector has done. They will be amplifying his resistance till he gets worse and worse. So we've created this huge pool of chronic drug-resistant patients who are spreading infection right across the community. You talked about our public sector woes and the fact that we've chronically underinvested in public health. Isn't it a shame that this country has never spent more than 1% of its GDP on health? We know that the TB program is an underperforming, underfunded program. The staff are poorly paid, overstretched, there's bureaucracy. Drugs are substandard often. There are often periods of time when drugs are just not available. And I've called this public policy paralysis, really. Our patients end up, sadly, in public wards like this, Siuri Hospital. It is Dante's hell, if you want to visit, I would say. It's a public TB sanatorium, really. And they end up in wards like this, which are neither fit for human or animal at all. What if this patient chooses to go down the private sector? Well, it's a huge I hang my head in shame because I am part of the private sector, but it's a huge, unengaged, unregulated, exploitative private sector. Huge number of hospitals are privately run. Most doctors engage in private practice in this country. 50% of all doctors in this country are non-MBBS and have lots of alternative faiths. We call them the Ayush doctors, Ayurveds, yoga, etc., etc. And we know that poor knowledge, poor training, dismal prescribing practices occur with the private sector. The sign of one such doctor, I've put his name, cancelled his name. I think he's quite dynamic because it says physical and surging, but I think they mean physician and surgeon. And it's doctors like this who many of our patients end up visiting. And this doctor actually practiced in Dharavi, population density 1 million per square mile. Many of my patients come from here. And this is probably one of my most cited papers, actually, and it wasn't a difficult one to write because we asked a simple question to Dharavi doctors, 100 of them. We lured them to this talk I was going to give by offering them free lunch. And then when they were captive, we gave them this questionnaire and insisted they answer it. And we asked them just one simple question. What treatment would you give a 50-kilo patient with MDR-TB? And the results in plus one were quite startling. Only 5 prescriptions were considered appropriate. 5. So 95% served only to amplify resistance in this hot spot of TB Dharavi, actually converting MDR to XDR and beyond. And this looks like a Venn diagram, but this is just the tortuous path a patient takes as he tries desperately to cure himself of his TB. He goes to the private, he goes to the public, he goes to the Ayush, he goes to the chemists, which are often the first providers, really, of drugs in this country. We have 1 million chemists and 1,000 drug controllers in this country. And I've put up again 2 prescriptions which we audited. The one on the left is from the Ayush doctor and Ayurved for established TB patients. His prescription read, cough syrups and vitamins, no TB drugs. He didn't give the TB patient a single TB drug. And look what the MBBS doctor did. More drugs, but not better again. Unnecessary antibiotics. TB drugs accounted for only 3% of the cost of the prescription. But this 1 week prescription was more than this rickshaw driver's monthly income. So Shakespeare had it right, didn't he? He said, trust not the physician. His antidotes are poison, and he slays more than you bandits rob, for he takes wealth and life together. Why did you choose to go private? I asked 200 of my TB patients at the Hinduja Hospital. Why? You can ill afford to. 77% of Indian TB patients live on less than $1 a day. You don't go into practicing, specializing in TB if you want to make money, as you can see. And the answers they gave were the usual answers, which I think weak healthcare systems suffer from. Rude staff in the public sector. That's why I came to you at Hinduja. Uncaring, no privacy, inflexible times. But one answer scrawled across the form stuck in my mind. He said, Doc, the government clinics are supposed to be free, but their kind of free no one can afford. And of course, then it's a very complex and demanding disease to treat, as you've seen. It's just very, very long. It's a long distance race. Debilitating side effects. They end up blind, deaf, with failed kidneys. It's extremely expensive. It's a question of realpolitik, isn't it, healthcare-wise? Because I can treat 5,000 drug-sensitive patients for what it costs to treat one MDR-TB patient. So costs have to be factored in. And as a result, the cure rates are poor and default rates are dreadful. What is the cost? In New Zealand, it would cost you $300,000 to cure one patient with pre-XDR-TB. That's one step before XDR. We've showed that we can cut that cost down, cutting corners perhaps to as low as $5,600. But that is a lot of money because that averages, we've shown, about 200% of the patient's income. So the health economics have to be looked at as well. Drugs are just not available. There is a pipeline of sorts. And it's just spat out one very, very important drug called bedaquiline, a game changer. And this is a highly effective drug. It was FDA approved 5 years ago, but it's a scandal because it's impossible to access in the country where it was manufactured. That allows hundreds of thousands of Indian MDR-TB patients to die. The drug is made in factories in Gujarat but exported across the world, but Indian patients are not allowed to access it. The reason, the government says, is because of fears of catastrophic spread of resistance in the community if used without enough background drugs. You need not just one drug, but at least three or four to cure these patients. This is a slightly sad slide because this is a patient who moved the High Court. She's called in medical legal circles as the Patna girl. And her father was a government official. Her name is Shreya. And when the AIIMS refused to give her the drug, saying, no, we don't give it to you, she came to me at Hinduja Hospital. I said, haven't you heard about this new drug? It could save your life. Her father actually went back and filed a case in the High Court. The next thing I know, a famous lawyer, Grover, had taken it on pro bono. And she won the case. And the family said, go back to your doctor in Bombay and let him give the drug. So she came back to me. They rented Surrey a flat in New Bombay. They could not afford to. He was a government official. We were cautioning against just this, of course, that denying access to bedaquiline in India costs lives in the Lancet. And the lady you see with her is a wonderful doctor from Harvard, Jennifer Furin, who actually stuck her neck out and gave affidavit on her behalf and then came to visit her when she came to visit me and used to send her presents, small presents by mail, really, really big-hearted girl. And she said this, we can no longer be satisfied with protecting a drug when we should be protecting people's lives. This Patna girl's case is an example of India's failure in TB policy and practice. They should have thousands of people like this brave young girl on bedaquiline. It's a sad story because Shreya had finished about 1.5 years of treatment but was brought in dead to the Hinduja Hospital casualty about a month ago. It was too late, basically. The drug she'd received had come so late that her lungs had been ravaged and fibrosed by TB. She was on oxygen. She had a miserable end. Non-communicable diseases are driving the TB epidemic as well because strong links have been shown now with all these diseases where India, again, is number one. So TB and poverty is a strong link. We know that your nutritional status is strongly linked to TB. India is the diabetes capital of the world, and diabetics are 3 times more likely to get TB than non-diabetes. Smoking is linked to TB, and biomass exposure, which is rampant in our villages, is also a risk factor for TB. And then there are the macro-level intangibles, as I call them, the public health policy failures. And I've written that many of our problems have arisen from policy failures. Government callousness, bureaucratic short-sightedness, and MDR-TB is no exception. You can see why I'm so popular in government circles. And I love this quote from The Economist, which says, of all the ills that kill the poor, none is as effective as bad government. So I'm going to conclude here, ladies and gentlemen. Imagine, if you will, the panic if the WHO announced today that a new, highly infectious airborne disease would claim 1.6 million lives over the next year. Just imagine. And they said that there was no vaccine, that there was just a weak quota of drugs, there was treatment which lasted for 2 years, and there was a high odd rate of developing lethal MDR strains. Of course, the world's leaders would then be galvanized into action immediately. You know from my talk that this is not fiction. It describes a disease that has never really gone away. So how are we doing? Not too well, I'm afraid. And all these major parameters, limited schedule, unscheduled delays, limited service, sadly. I'm always asked, okay, since you think you're so smart, what would you do if you were health minister? So I always make this 10-point wish list to save you the bother of asking me. We need a point of care test. A point of care test meaning a test as your patient comes in with TB. The test is so fast, it tells you whether he has tuberculosis or not, a patient with suspected TB, that is. We have this wonderful test called the Gene Expert, little pods which you put into an espresso-like machine, and within 6 to 9 hours gives you an answer, yes, TB, yes, drug-resistant or sensitive. We need to roll this out across the country because at present the ratio of expert machines to the population is about 1 or 2 per million. So we need to roll this out like bank cashiers all over. We need a network of really good labs. We have very, very few in this country. We need the new drugs, the new regimes that we've heard about for patients like Shreya. We need a new TB vaccine. The BCG vaccine, some people feel it gives efficacy, which is 0%. We all receive it as kids, as children. But a major study from India showed its efficacy in that study was 0%. political will, of course, not political statement, but political will, funding. The current funding gap is 1.6 billion per year. That's how much more we need. Legislation so that only qualified doctors can treat this disease. Why should a homeopath and an Ayurved be allowed to treat a disease as demanding as drug-resistant TB? We need a private-public mix, and I know this is a subject close to Rajiv's heart, because there's this dysfunctional relation between the public sector and the private sector. We look at each other with positions of mistrust. We have a new TB in charge in this city, Daksha, who's making great progress and trying to reach out and build bridges, but we need to do more of that. And we need to focus on the biosocial, the poverty, the malnutrition, the housing, the quality of air, because really TB is the perfect expression of an imperfect civilization. And I'm going to end with, again, a slide of one of my patients. A famous Canadian photographer called Robert Nactwee won a TED Prize and chose to spend his money shooting pictures of drug-resistant, he was a war photographer, chose to spend his money taking pictures of drug-resistant TB patients across the globe. And he came to us and took a picture of this patient, of ours, who was by then at Zarir Hospital. Look at the needle trying to puncture his bone because there is no space left, really. There's no muscle left. And I'll end with this quote from my personal hero, someone that's a Harvard connection again, who someone who spent some time in our clinic some time ago. He said, "So I can't show you how exactly healthcare is a basic human right. But what I can argue is that no one should have to die of a disease that is treatable." And I think that is something that all of us in this hall, whether we're from Boston or Bombay, all agree on. Thank you very much.
Questions, if you have three, four questions.
So you showed a wish list.
Yeah.
Would you wish that all used handkerchiefs when sneezing and coughing?
Yes, of course. Basic hygiene is very much on that wish list.
There was no mention of it anywhere.
Well, I wanted to keep it to 10, but maybe that would have been 11.
Another thing.
Yeah.
Is it due to reasons of the compulsion to subsidize life-saving drugs by the government, that the R&D in the public sector is getting discouraged? In which case, agencies like ICMR and places like that, they could be making it mandatory that people, I mean, who carry away, there are scientists who carry away crores of rupees for research. Can't they define the sort of priority topics that they should work through?
I agree with that. It's also a question of the drug quality, the bioavailability. Fake drugs, spurious drugs, you know, when 100 different fly-by-night companies will make a drug which is life-saving. So all these factors.
One last question.
Yeah.
It's a suggestion, actually. Isn't it a hijack if we say that hand washes can save you from swine flu and things like that?
Sorry, isn't it a
hijack from truth if we say, or if we publicize in the media, that hand washes is a remedy for keeping swine flu, H1N1.
Well, hand washes have a major role, I would say, in any viral or influenza or disease generally, in order to prevent transmission to the next patient. So.
But aerosol-borne diseases?
Yes, no, it doesn't apply to some diseases, of course.
Handkerchief would be better in place.
Yeah, so I don't wash my hands or wear a mask.
Thank you. My name is Ignatius Konikara. I'm a retired associate professor of microbiology, Calicut University.
I mean, here, this guy's questions for me.
Dr. Udwadia, every time we've interacted with the health ministry people in Delhi, they get paralyzed because they seem to be always worried about these unintended consequences. For instance, DDT, they feel that that was a great victory by not banning DDT in India. They saved many malaria lives also. There was great pressure on them. And on this, through the public system supplying drugs, they are mortally scared that somehow some massive drug-resistant epidemic will come, and therefore they prefer not to do anything. I mean, it's a very difficult conundrum that they are faced with. Is there some way we can have more constructive dialogue with them and actually make progress rather than get into this polarized paralysis?
Well, as I said, we really need to be building bridges between the public and private sector. The new leader of TB control in the city and the state seems to be quite enlightened, you know. And I'd like to publicly thank Jerry, because often when my poor patients run out of funds, we approach his trust and organization. And he's got deep pockets and has always helped so many of us. Thanks, Jerry.
I'm a pediatrician, and I'm just surprised to see that most of the patients who are suffering from MDR-TB, the relatives and the small children in their family are not given any prophylaxis in India at present. So should we not change the policy?
That's a very important question, but the honest answer is that there is no prophylaxis for MDR-TB. It's not like...
For the relatives.
I'm talking of the relatives, because they are resistant to isoniazid and rifampicin, and so there is nothing you can offer them. So when one patient in the house, in a small house of 10 people, has TB, all I can advise is wear a mask, because we know that reduces transmission by 50%, and quickly start the index case on his or her drugs. But there is no protection that you can give. No one would recommend amikacin, for example, or a quinolone. There are studies just now looking at a newer drug called delaminate to see if it gives prophylaxis to family contacts. But right now, it's a very difficult session. The WHO's current recommendation is just follow up these contacts very carefully, do x-rays every 6 months, but there's no protective drug you can give them. But it's an important, a very important issue.
Speak question. So you... In one of your maps, most brilliantly pointed out that the map of TB and the map of poverty match perfectly. It poses one very specific problem, and many problems, but one very specific problem, which is it makes creating new drugs for TB a really bad business model for the global pharmaceutical industries. Beyond just browbeating them and telling them they must do the right thing, what are things that we can do? Because the way we get out of this, beyond dealing with the social issues and poverty, one of your top 10 lists is that we do need new treatments. So do you have thoughts about how to spur on more activity on new drugs for TB?
So, you know, only 5% of all TB occurs in the EU and in the Americas. So it's naturally not a priority, because those are the ones who can afford to fund these studies. It takes about 500 million, I think, to get a new drug from the bench to the bedside. So why should they do it when 95% of TB is focused in people who can't afford $1 a day? I think still, despite this, some of the brightest minds in medicine, and Harvard is an example, Johns Hopkins, who we collaborate with, are working in. So it's so gratifying to see great American minds, European minds, working in the field of tuberculosis. And I think perhaps in these days of migration, when people realize, like you said, that TB in Africa is TB in Boston, for example, because someone can hop onto a plane, get through custom control without any problems, and cough and cause a mini epidemic in Boston. So TB in one place is TB everywhere. And I think as the world gets more global, people realize that.
May I request Dr. Farooq Udwadia to say a few words?
I think you've pointed out the dreadfulness of the problem, as we all know. I think the disease is so intimately linked with the socio-economic problems in this country, the poverty that exists, the crowded sort of state of living, the poor sanitation, the poor nutrition. You know, all these, I think, are extremely important from the long-term point of view to deal with tuberculosis. It is a sad thing that the treatment in the public center and in the private center is not properly organized. And it is a fact that it's an iatrogenic disease, MDR-TB, because if you were to treat the sensitive TB, TB which is sensitive to the drugs that one normally uses, if you were to treat that well, if the patients took their medication well, the incidence of MDR-TB would fall. But now it's reached to a point where you're going to get an arithmetic, if not a geometric progression of MDR-TB for obvious reasons. So we are really in a conundrum, if you ask me.
guests, Dr. Udwadia and Dr. Jha. Please give a round of applause for this wonderful, very informative talk and very, very useful at the juncture where our country needs more awareness and campaign about such diseases. And TV in particular is very important. So to end this program, we would like to thank on behalf of Nehru Science Centre and our council, National Council of Science Museums. We had very good and very cooperative collaboration with some institutions and support from individuals and institutions. Because of them, we have made this exhibition successful today. And I can say this word after this successful event with such a wonderful talk by Dr. Udwadia. So first of all, sir, Dr. Udwadia, thank you so much for giving your quality of time. I understand you have very strong commitment just after that, and you are here with us with full patience. That's a very big deal for all of us. So thank you, sir. And Dr. Jha, for coming all the way from your institution, which is our collaborative institution for this program, and also Dean William, ma'am, Dr. William. Though she is not well, but she has conveyed her message and all these dignitaries. And apart from that, some institution. First of all, National Museum of Natural History. Actually, this institute has curated this exhibition of international portion, and Indian part is curated by Nehru Science Center by our director, sir. And Harvard Global Health Institute, Dr. Jha's Institute, I should say, and Harvard T-Chan School of Public Health India Research Center in Mumbai. ACS Society India, and particularly Ma'am Banti Chan, with her support and encouragement, this program became possible for all of us. And KEM Hospital, in particular, Dr. Geeta Natarajan. She helped us a lot. And KEM is very important hospital in our city to really understand the path sir was showing, public path. And KEM is playing a very crucial role in that. And after that, Department of Community Medicine from KEM Hospital, Dr. Rujita Hadai. She helped a lot in researching because she is the one she is working with her community workers, doctors, and resident doctors, and really going on those areas which are really important to be addressed and capturing and doing documentation, and she shared some very important information with us for this exhibition. And dengue malaria controlled by insecticide branch, public health department, municipal corporation of Greater Mumbai, which we call BMC Mumbai. Thank you, BMC, for always supporting Mumbai's growth. Hafkin Institute of Training, Research and Testing, Mumbai, very important institute, and most of us may be familiar, it's very crucial role for our city. National Center for Disease Control, though, as sir has narrated to Dr. Jha, we were having very small time, but some big institution came on board with us, whatever time they have left to support us. So we should thank to them as well. And none other than team from Harvard Global Health Institute, which is led by Dr. Sana. And Dr. Sana is in US, but with us today we have Ms. Ambika from Harvard Global Health Institute. So please give a round of applause for efforts they have put. And long months for collaborative effort became reality because of both hands' very positive, proactive support. And the last but the not least, team from Nehru Science Center directly or indirectly worked for this project. And we are going to host maybe some educational program in coming months. And our media friends from print and electronic for giving your quality of time, because that is very important for communicating our important message to the society. Thank you, everyone.